Hello. So today I am going to do a video comparing the dance scenes from the remake Cinderella movie and the remake Beauty and the Beast movie. Now you might be thinking, how can I compare these? Isn't that kind of like comparing apples to oranges? Because these are two different movies with different stories, different characters. How can you compare them? But these two scenes actually have a lot more in common than you might think. Here are just a handful of the similarities. It features an ordinary girl who goes to a castle in a dress that was given to her with a little bit of magical help, which she shows off at the top of a staircase before slowly and dramatically walking down said staircase. Then she has a dance with the prince character, which moves along the story and also, most importantly, the romantic relationship between the two characters. And even after the dance scene, both movies have a couple of smaller scenes developing the story and the relationship before she runs away from the castle abruptly. So those are just a few similarities in the movies themselves, but then there's other things like these movies were released only 2 years apart. Cinderella came out in 2015, while Beauty and the Beast came out in 2017. And so Cinderella was fresh on everyone's minds when Beauty and the Beast came out. And so there's a lot of comparing between these movies that is happening already, and I would just like to throw in my two cents comparing some of the differences between the dance scenes specifically from these two movies. And if you know anything about me, you'll know that this is basically going to be a praise of Cinderella and a roast of Beauty and the Beast, if you didn't know that already going into this. First thing to talk about is chemistry. I'm going to use this fairly broadly because each of the points I'm going to talk about after this is going to expound on this, but I just want to point out that the point of this scene is to progress the chemistry and romantic relationship between Kit and Ella and the Beast and Belle. That is the whole purpose of this scene. There are some subplots going on, especially in Cinderella, where it shows the king and him being converted over to Cinderella and the stepmother and the sisters being jealous of her. But the main focus of this scene is to progress the relationship between the main characters. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and talk about more aspects of this scene. Let's talk about cinematography. So in Cinderella, there's a wonderful balance between wide shots, mid shots, and close-ups. Most of the scene is shot mid-shot, where you are able to see both characters, but you still have a pretty good sense of space and you're able to still feel movement. But there are the occasional wide shots that really highlight the dance, the dress, and then they have the few close-up shots that really help develop the romantic feeling between the two characters. And so I feel like that scene was executed very well in the balance between those shots. It really keeps your interest and helps tell the story with those different kinds of close-up shots. But in Beauty and the Beast, almost the entire scene is shot really wide. I'm not sure why it's backed up so much because there's nothing else to look at other than Belle and the Beast. There's no one else in the room. And then every once in a while, they do come in for a mid shot to show both characters, but it's not very effective, and I'm gonna go into that more a little bit later. But there's hardly any close-ups. Really, the only ones are at the very beginning of the dance during the first dance move, and then at the end when they're about to walk out onto the balcony. And so there's really not a whole lot of connection that we're getting between the two characters because so much of the scene is shot really wide. I'm not sure what they were thinking there, but it really doesn't help the story and characters progress. A very important component of this scene, the choreography. I actually have some very strong opinions on this. In Cinderella, I love this choreography because it feels very organic and believable. Where in the beginning, when the prince says that he's going to lead her through this dance, that's really what it feels like is going on. I've taken enough social dance classes and gone to enough dances in my life to know that if you have someone who is a good leader, a man who can lead very well, and a woman who is willing to follow and understands those cues, the dance that you see in Cinderella is, for the most part, pretty plausible and believable for him to be able to lead her through that. There are definitely a couple of moves that would have required rehearsal and practice, or they would have known, had to know ahead of time in order to be able to do. And having that dress, that would definitely take some practice, but just the dance movements themselves are pretty basic, and I like that because it makes it so much more believable, and because the movements are fairly slow, the camera is able to focus on the characters more because there's not a ton of movement. You can see them pretty clearly because a lot of the actions are fairly repetitive. And so I love that choreography, and just how many twirls there are and such shows off the dress beautifully. Love it. But in Beauty and the Beast, I actually had this thought the first time I went and saw this movie in theaters. I felt like it was way too choreographed. As soon as it starts and they start progressing across the dance floor, I remember thinking, like, did they practice this ahead of time? Like, how did they both know this dance and know all the dance moves to be able to do this dance together? Like, it just felt way too orchestrated and forced. Unnatural. It felt unnatural. And so as beautiful as the choreography is, I don't know, it takes me out of the experience a little bit because I was just wondering, like, how do they both know this dance? And another problem with the choreography is there is a lot of movement. A lot of it is very quick. There's a lot of spinning. And so what happens is you can't see their expressions very well because anytime it tries to close up on their face, they are spinning, they are moving. You are not able to see the connection between the two characters well. So I just don't think the choreography was very smart in that way, that you were able to see the characters' faces well. It's really focusing much more on that dance and that movement, which on paper isn't a bad idea, but in execution, watching it, to me, it is just distracting how choreographed it felt. And I unfortunately think that takes away from the love story. Now let's focus in on the acting. Because as I said, this is supposed to be a romantic scene that progresses their relationship. So let's talk about the acting of our lead characters. In Cinderella, one of my favorite parts about this scene is the prince's expression. Kit just looks so genuinely happy to see Ella there. You can just feel the affection coming from him during the whole scene, and I just love it. And then Ella, of course, who's just giddy to be at this ball, see her friend, turns out it's the prince. Like, she's just on cloud nine in this situation, and it shows on Lily James's face. You can just feel how happy they are, and through the progression of the dance, you see them falling more and more in love. It is just so beautiful to see their relationship progress, which is helped a lot with the cinematography and choreography, as I have already talked about. You are able to see that relationship happen with the acting. Now, in Beauty and the Beast, I don't feel like it came across as well, and that's for a few different reasons, one of which is the Beast character is a CGI character. Now, there's a lot that they can do with CGI. There have been plenty of CGI characters on screen that are totally believable and emote a lot of expression and emotion. For some reason in this movie, I feel like through the whole movie, they really struggled with the Beast getting that genuine expression across. And I think that happened in this scene as well, where it's like, he might be falling in love with Belle, I don't know, but I can't tell, I can't see his face, I can't read it through those special effects. And on Belle's side, I've expressed in the past how I think Emma Watson was miscast for this part, and in this scene, she kind of just opted to go for her just kind of standard, straight, mildly pleased face, which really doesn't get the story across that you're falling in love. Like, she has the same expression at the beginning as she does at the end. I don't know. Unfortunately, I don't feel like she gave a very convincing performance in this scene to progress their relationship further, which was not helped by the quick choreography. I wish if we had just gotten a couple of really solid shots on her face, maybe I would be able to absorb it better, but it's all just so quick. I'm not able to believe the love story that they're trying to progress in this scene. This next topic might seem a little bit random, but I'm going to talk about the lighting. I'm actually just using this as an opportunity to complain about something I have a problem with in a lot of movies nowadays, which is poor lighting. In Cinderella, they did a good job. The place is very well lit. You can see things clearly. The colors are vibrant. I love it. But in Beauty and the Beast, they fall into this trap that I've seen so many movies fall into where everything is so dim. Like, most pictures and footage that I'm bringing up on screen here, I personally have gone and brought up the brightness on because it's just so dark and dim. Which also fights trying to progress any sort of story when it's just like, I can't see their faces, I can't see what's going on. Why is it so dimly lit? I don't understand. Anyway, that's really all I have to say on that subject. I just wanted to use this as an excuse to be able to complain about how I don't feel like movies are lit very well nowadays usually, and I feel like Cinderella did it right, where through nearly the entire movie, you can see stuff and it just makes it so much more energetic and vibrant and beautiful that you can actually tell what's going on in the story. And then there are these movies where it's just like, you can't see anything. Like I get, maybe they were going for a more historically aesthetic setting where it's like everything is lit by candlelight, or, you know, there's no electric lights to make things super bright. Maybe they were trying to make it more historically authentic. Great. Good for you. But if I can't see the character's expressions, I'm not going to care about your story or your characters. So a little artificial light might be beneficial. And then I wouldn't be me if I didn't talk about the dresses. I absolutely love Cinderella's dress. I've talked about it a little bit before, and I could talk about it forever. It is a masterpiece. Sandy Powell deserves all the credit in the world for creating such an amazing dress. It is a feat of engineering. If you understand all the structure that goes on underneath, it's baffling. And then just how creative she was with the different kinds of fabrics layered up on top to give it an incredible amount of depth, even though it is a full-length skirt, so you think you might be limited in what you're able to do when you just have like one sheet of fabric, but she was able to give it so much character and personality and depth with how clever she was with what fabric she was using and how it's cut. And goodness, I would recommend going over to Bella May Design's channel. She recreated a movie accurate replica of this dress and did an entire series on it. Go watch it if you're interested in like the deep dive of how this dress was made, because it is baffling just how genius this dress is. And it's so beautiful to watch. Watching it twirl just transports you to a different world. You feel like you're in a fairy tale. And that's what I feel like these princess dresses are supposed to do, is they are supposed to give you a magical feeling. And that's what Cinderella's really does for me. It's nothing like I've ever seen before. It's completely unique. It's not something you would find off the rack. And I can't really compare it to anything else I've seen in other movies. Sure, there are similarities, like having poofy shoulders. Disney's done that for a while. But just how she was able to make it happen with real fabric, with that much depth, and the butterflies and everything, she just made it so unique and beautiful. If I was forced to come up with some nitpick about this look and this dress, it would probably be, I feel like Cinderella has a little too much glam on her skin. It's a little over the top and a little bit too much for me, but it's fine because it plays into the skirt. There's nothing sparkly on the top of the dress, and so having that glitter up top match the bottom of the dress works. And so I really don't mind it, and it's not too distracting. You're able to get over it pretty quick. I really love Cinderella's dress. Now, Belle's dress. I have done an entire video on this, how I don't like this dress. So I'll sum up my thoughts a little bit and maybe add some more that I haven't talked about before. I feel like there was a lot that went in behind this dress that just did not translate onto screen. Like, if you go and look at the actual construction, the techniques that they used, materials they used, there is a lot of brilliance behind it, but none of it came across on screen. Once again, one of the biggest enemies of this being how everything is shot so wide. A lot of the gold on the dress could have been more upfront and spectacular if it was shown more, but it's just all so far back that it just gets washed out and you don't even know it's there. Now, one of my biggest complaints that I have brought up about this dress is that I just don't feel like it's fancy enough, because it's not. Just in and of itself, like, this is a very special occasion. They're in a castle. She's with royalty. She should be wearing something a lot more formal and spectacular. But then also the context of the film that they've created. They have very intentionally set this in mid-17th century France court dress. And so it should be spectacular because they've set that expectation up. And it's not. I just wish it was more formal looking and more special. Like, it feels like something that you could just go and buy at a store. I wish it was something that looked more unique and singular and special to this movie. I know that one of the qualities they wanted with it is they wanted Emma to be able to move very easily in it because she's an active character. And so they wanted her to be able to move freely in it. But that doesn't make sense, because they talk about how they wanted her to be able to ride a horse later on. But when you are getting dressed for a fancy dance, a ball scene, you're not thinking about how you might be riding a horse later. You're thinking about that dance scene. So why would she be so insistent on wearing a dress that she'd be able to ride a horse in when that's not your plan? Like, it just doesn't make sense to me that she didn't get appropriately addressed for the occasion that she was dressing for. Anyway. There are some things that I understand how it could have maybe worked. Having the different layers could have been really cool moving around because they wanted the dress to dance well. That's something I've heard them say in the behind the scenes. But I unfortunately just don't think it worked. I think there needed to have been more tests done before they actually filmed, because in theory, having that organza would make a lot of sense to give it a lot of movement, but because of the quick choreography that's there, it doesn't have time to flow and open up. It's just whipped around, so it didn't work on screen. So I think they should have tested that a little bit more so that they would know it doesn't work with that dance before going ahead and putting it in the final film. I could talk about this dress for a lot longer. I'll just say that I wish it was more formal. If nothing else, keep the design, but make the sleeves mid-length sleeve, or give her gloves, or put her hair up. They could have kept the design, but then just glammed it up a little bit with some better jewelry or something. I don't know. I'm just very disappointed in that dress, and I'm gonna stop talking about it now. Honestly, Belle probably could have gotten away with this dress if Beauty and the Beast had come out before Cinderella, because companies all the time are trying to one-up themselves, right? They are always wanting to improve and get better. And so if Belle's dress had come out, we would have been in awe of it. It would have been spectacular and great. And then if 2 years later Cinderella's dress came out, we would have been like, oh wow, look how much cooler, better, and we would have still been impressed by both. And so unfortunately, I feel like Cinderella's dress set the bar really high, and so Belle's dress had quite a bit to live up to, and it didn't do that. If it had come out first, maybe they could have gotten away with it, but because it came out after Cinderella's, it didn't. Last little thing I'm going to touch on is the duration. How long this scene lasts. This is just going to be real quick. I just wanted to throw this out here because I found it to be kind of interesting, is the length of these scenes, and that the Beauty and the Beast one is actually quite a bit shorter. So I timed this scene from the first dance move to the last dance move, and Cinderella came out a full minute longer than Beauty and the Beast, which is kind of rough. If you're trying to tell a love story in this scene, you might want to give it as much time as you can. I mean, I know they were stuck with the song Beauty and the Beast from the original movie, so I don't know how much more they could have dragged it out. But actually, to try and help it, I actually also timed it from the time that their eyes meet for the first time to the last dance move to maybe try and help out Beauty and the Beast a little bit, but it didn't work. It still comes in a full minute shorter than Cinderella. I'm not quite sure why they made it so much shorter, especially since there's a quote Emma Watson said where she said that this scene is really where you start to understand that the love story is happening between these two characters and that they're falling in love. I don't think that's an awful idea. On paper, I can see how that would work, is if the love story was a little bit more slow through the movie, but then the dance scene is really where the romance happened, cool. But all of these things I have just discussed totally hinder that and make it not happen. And making the scene so much shorter doesn't help you in that either. Anyway, I just found it very interesting that the Beauty and the Beast scene was so much shorter than the Cinderella one. That's all I have to say about that. I just wanted to point it out because I thought it was kind of interesting. So there you have it. There's my comparison of these two dance scenes. Usually I compare movies from their original to their remake, right? So it's a much more equal comparison. But I feel like these two scenes are just so easy to compare because of all the similarities and because they were released so close together. And so I wanted to talk about that because I see people talk about it a lot in comments and in conversations, but I've never seen a video on it. So there is my analysis of the comparison between the 2015 Cinderella dance scene and the 2017 Beauty and the Beast dance scene. So hopefully you enjoyed yourself if you made it all the way through this video. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you have a great rest of your day. Bye!